Thanks for joining us this week for another edition of Workout Matters, the Thanksgiving show. This week, Robert and I give thanks to friends, colleagues, and those that we love for their contribution to our success. Additionally, Robert and I talk about the fires that have raged Southern California, global warming, and Robert gives a special segment on how to pass the California bar exam. All that plus news of the week on this edition of Workout Matters. And now, without further ado, here's the Thanksgiving show. Thanks for listening.
A long, long time ago, I can still remember how that music used to make me smile. And I knew if I had my chance that I could make those people dance, and maybe they'd be happy for a while. But February made me shiver with every paper I'd deliver. Bad news on the doorstep, I couldn't take one more step. I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride, but something touched me deep inside the day the music died.
From the Roundtable at Uncle's Studios in beautiful Southern California, welcome to another edition of Workout Matters, the central location for you employee, you employers, and of course you independent contractors. My name is Steve Appel, and I'll be your host for the next hour with some talk, some news, and hopefully some answers about Workout Matters. Thanks for being part of the show, and if you can break away from your Workout Matters, feel free to give us a call and clue us in with your questions, comments, and or concerns. Phone number worldwide, 818-357-4120. You can send me an email to wcexaminer@aol.com. Heck, you can be old school and send a fax, 818-475-1437. With me in studio, my protege, attorney Robert Ozeron, Scott Walton from Uncle's Studio on the board taking care of the technical difficulties, back in Munich, Germany, John Scalia, back at Workout Central, making sure the whole damn thing goes right, is Mr. Jake Paris. Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Work Comp Matters. This is the Thanksgiving show. We were not on last week because of the events that took place, but we are back, and it's simply me and Robert in the studio. How you doing, my boy?
I'm good, boss. Happy Thanksgiving.
Happy Thanksgiving to you, too. I hope you and the family are safe and as unaffected as possible from the events that have occurred in the last week or two.
Yeah, it's too bad what happened. But yeah, I live out here in San Fernando Valley, so I'm far removed, it seems, from the events on the news that are only miles away. It's kind of strange, actually.
As I've said many times, I live in Woodland Hills, actually right near Pierce College, which is where they were keeping the animals safe as part of the fires. But I've got a lot of family that is in Thousand Oaks. In fact, that's where I'm going tomorrow for Thanksgiving. And family members were under mandatory evacuations, but fortunately, they were shortly thereafter lifted, and all of their homes and communities, at least their immediate neighborhoods, are safe. I wanted to speak for a moment about some of the events. Of course, we've got some news stories on the fire, also in Thousand Oaks, and all of this broke out the day after the last show. There was the horrific senseless shooting at Borderline Bar and Grill. where a lot of my family has also gone. Fortunately, none of them were there at the time. I know that Scott has colleagues that have played there. I've personally never been there. And then, of course, shortly after that, the fires broke out. And I have learned a new term today, or the past couple of days, road diet. My boy, have you ever heard of the term road diet?
No, I haven't. But
that is essentially where you take the same amount of road, like, and I'm specifically referring to that main road that goes from like Paradise to Chico, where it's originally four lanes, and then they compact it, they diet it down to two lanes. And I've been reading stories and listening to the news, and this apparently was a main contributing factor why so many people died in the Paradise fire. I mean, their cars just melted on the road because they couldn't get out. That street used to be four lanes, and now it's only two. So if you ever get a chance, take a look at road diet. And Paradise, the city of Paradise, I think the population there is about 27,000. And apparently the word is that the state government gave them a couple of million dollars to fix their roads. But as a precursor to fixing the roads, they had to agree to perform road diet, turn the four-lane highway into a two-lane highway. And then people died in their cars. It's
so
horrible.
What was the point of the narrowing of the thoroughfare? Is it for the savings regarding
the state of California and the government? Want to say the liberal Democrats? They want people to stop driving cars. They want people out of their cars.
It's not to lower the cost of road maintenance or something
no,
like that.
No, it's to get people out of their cars, which is really interesting because California was originally after World War II and the development of the backyard barbecues in the San Fernando Valley, California became the place where you could stretch out. You didn't have people living on top of each other. And because they didn't put all the money into public transportation, they put the money into selling new cars. California was the superhighway, the 405 freeway, the 101. You could get out and go in your cars. And California was the place where people mostly, they got along by transportation in their cars. And this is how come people nowadays, and of course, I would never do it. People commute from Palmdale to downtown LA. It's like 150 miles.
Yeah.
Oh, I could never do that. 150 miles round trip a day. And I could never do that. But this is what I'm being told, and I firmly believe as one of the contributing factors, and we've got news stories on that.
I think Governor Jerry Brown met with President Trump recently.
We've got a story on that. Yeah. President Trump came to California, and it was Governor Jerry Brown and Governor-elect Gavin Newsom were with him for part of the time as he viewed the damage in the fires.
And then later, I believe they discussed loosening logging restrictions to try to thin out these forests. But it looks like the loosening of the restrictions was only moving the diameter of the tree that could be timber, like harvested, from 24 to 36 inches.
And then he was making comparisons to other brush and trees that are in other countries, and it's just not the same.
Oh, I mean 36 to 24 inches, something like that. So you could harvest smaller trees, apparently. But apparently these forests are overgrown and not well maintained. And in the name of environmentalism, they've let them kind of be overgrown because it's so tragic to see a single tree cut down. But, you know, not many environmentalists are talking about the fact that there was no maintenance in these areas and that it's just ripe for an enormous fire.
And also, I think what President Trump forgot is the forestry is the responsibility of the federal government, not state government.
That's true. Well, the federal forests, yeah. There are state parks as well.
Yeah,
and I'm not sure if these fires occurred in state or federal. I think they're actually occurred in state territory officially.
Well, a lot of the area that burned in Southern California between Thousand Oaks and Malibu is federal owned land.
You know, the Southern California fire, that's a little different to me because I feel like fires burning their way to the ocean is kind of natural. It's just how it happens. You can't stop a fire from burning its way through to the ocean.
Unless you have... Okay, I'm gonna say this wrong. I was going to say the perfect storm because we had the perfect storm here today. Not today, for the fires. We had the Santa Ana winds pick up right at the time when the humidity was at its lowest. And I remember the fires broke out within 24 hours of them coming out and saying, no burn areas. And within 24 hours, the fires picked up. Now,
yeah, it's a confluence of events.
Yeah. The rumors are, and there's evidence to lead, that these fires were started by down power poles, PG&E. I don't think anybody's put blame on the DWP, which is I'm part of, but PG&E, once again, the word is that their liability is up around $12 billion, and the company is not even worth half that. So they're talking about PG&E going bankrupt, of course. So now they're talking about relaxing the liability rules with the insurance companies, making PG&E not necessarily responsible for everything. And
well, I agree with that potentially. If you're saying that there's a defense that our forests were not maintained appropriately, then but for
the inappropriate maintenance, the poles.
They're saying that the damage wouldn't have been so bad if you had maintained your forest. We had one down power pole, right? Caused the fire, yeah. But because you have a bale of hay that you've been piling up there inappropriately like a hoarder, everything sparked. You know, one mistake, it leads to tremendous consequences. So I don't know. I think perhaps there is a lot of blame to be going around for the big fire. Definitely the ignition is obviously the easiest to blame.
Now, how much could it cost to put a circuit breaker every mile or two? So if a power line goes down, the power automatically shuts off.
Well,
how much would that cost?
I don't know if that would be the necessary fix. I'm not an electrician.
Neither am I.
Right, and I know electricity is, serious stuff, high-minded stuff. So it may not be something that I can answer, but hopefully that they take adequate precautions for sure. But they have a financial interest to do that. So they're probably already trying to take as many precautions as they can. They should be investigated after big events to confirm that they were taking the reasonable precautions that they could take. And then all the causes of why the fire was so bad should also be investigated, including liability for the state and perhaps federal, if you're saying that may intrude on federal lands as well. Also, we should look at our environmental laws regarding logging, because if these areas are overgrown because you can't log there, well, it's nice, hug a tree, but you can't do that if the whole forest is on fire. So you got to kind of see the whole picture. You got to see the forest through the trees.
Now, I remember growing up when I was a kid, I was a teenager, we would get the public service announcements. Smokey the Bear would come on and say, only you can prevent forest fires. Well, guess what? These forest fires were not caused by campfires getting out of control, by cigarettes being thrown out of the window. In all probability, it was caused by faulty power lines. Now, I don't see what is so difficult about finding out how and why the fires started. We have satellites revolving around the Earth that presumably can read a damn license plate off a car. How come we can't find out where, how, why, who, what, when these fires started? I don't get it.
Well, I mean, the moment that there's a fire, satellite wouldn't work, right, because of the smoke?
I actually didn't think of that, okay. But you can see the orange flames, the yellow flames around the smoke.
Maybe, but also, it's fire. You can't really depending on where you have a satellite. If a satellite was watching Earth at all times, at all moments, I would agree with you, totally. I don't know if we have that many satellites in that many locations that we're just recording the Earth at
all
times.
Isn't Google Maps all over? I mean, where you have a population, where you have a city, Google Maps is there, no?
It's not a live stream.
Not a live stream.
That's what you're asking for. You're asking to go on the internet and have a satellite move and take a photo based on what you'd like. You know, for example, that's what spy satellites do, right? And only certain people have satellites at their disposal, not like somebody just clicking around on the internet. What you get on Google Images is at one time, yes, there was a photo of that location from, you know, from above, from a satellite, and they stitch it together to give you the globe. But, you know, it's not a live image. You can't go outside and watch yourself like, oh, I'm looking at myself from space. That's not possible. You might see a picture of yourself if you're at your house or something, right? And you've been outside. You're like, oh, there I am. I'm captured on Google Earth. But you can't start spying on the North Koreans or nothing like that. Because why wouldn't you do that instead of, like, check out your own house? Wouldn't you be like, well, I wonder what they're up to?
And I have no desire to spy on the North Koreans anyway.
If you had a satellite at your disposal, what would you take a look at?
Good question.
Live stream satellite, a real satellite, like you're a CIA operative.
I just heard the Rolling Stones are going to be at the Coliseum or something like that. I think I'd like to check out an outdoor concert.
Yeah. That's cool. That's pretty cool. You check out an outdoor concert, see how it's going. I don't know if it comes with audio, though.
It probably doesn't. My name is Steve Appel. You're listening to WorkCom Matters, the Thanksgiving show. We're brought to you by A1 Law Santa Monica Tickets and ABC Rugs. If you want the number one computer management system used by more workers' compensation attorneys than any other system in the damn Kuiper Belt, give me a call at 818-357-4120 for your no-strings-attached money-back guarantee, $1 a day, A1 Law. And if you want the O's hard to get, sold out, even front row concert, sports, and theater tickets, give our buddy Brian a call at Santa Monica Tickets, 310-395-8587. And now here's a little something from ABC Rugs. ABC Rugs has been in the business of manufacturing and direct importation and exportation of Persian and Oriental rugs for more than 39 years. ABC Rugs is a direct importer and wholesaler of antique, Moroccan, Oriental, and Persian rugs. Established in 1978, ABC Rugs is definitely old school. 323-897-5444. That's ABC Rugs. 323-897-5444. And there goes ABC Rugs. You didn't read the AAA story, did you?
Not yet.
Yeah, okay. AAA projects that 54.3 million Americans will journey 50 miles or more away from home this Thanksgiving, a 4.8% increase over last year. Talking about getting in your cars and hitting the road, I'm sure that, you know, most people, I mean, unless you're traveling across the country for like a holiday or whatnot, I'm going to Thousand Oaks, so I'm driving about 20, 25 miles. What about you?
Calabasas.
Oh, there you go. It's close.
Yeah, it's also close. But I like staying in the San Fernando Valley. It's nice here.
I always like to stay close. I hate to drive long distances. I just don't like the potential for getting in accidents, the responsibilities, the crazy people on the road. I do my best to drive as carefully as possible. I realize that my life could be over within 5 seconds.
You know, yeah,
everything can change.
It's a real high stakes game out there in LA. Every time you get out, you gotta make sure to put your big boy. You know,
road rage, babe. Road rage.
Well, road rage. You got reckless drivers. You gotta be an adult. You gotta look around and be vigilant. You can't just be ignorant or of your surroundings.
How much space do you put between yourself and the car ahead of you?
Well, I think appropriate is about two car lengths, about a car and a half.
Well, appropriate is one car length for every 10 miles an hour you're driving. So if you're
driving, I'm talking about city streets, like what is it, like 3-4 car lengths then?
Well, every 10 miles an hour, one car length. So if you're driving 60 miles an hour, that's 6 car lengths. You can also use the 2-second rule, which is that you mark the spot where the car is in front of you. You then count 1-2. And if you have already passed that spot, you're driving too far. Now, that being said, I like to give myself about 3 or 4 seconds or a car length and a half per 10 miles an hour. You know, I'm getting up in age. My reflexes aren't as quick as yours anymore. So I give myself some more space just in case.
Maybe you should get one of those cars that have the laser in the front where you can't rear end the car in front of you.
I don't even know anything about that. Tell me more.
Well, that's pretty much it. I have it in my car.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
It, and mine is a 2-year-old Mercedes. It's not even nothing new or recent.
I have a five-year-old Honda.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, time to upgrade, I think, to something that can get you that safety that you'd like. I think you would enjoy that because if your reflexes are slower as you're getting a little older, maybe
I was being a little tongue-in-cheek there.
I got you. But you know what? For your safety, I'm just looking out for you, boss.
I totally appreciate it.
I want you around for a while.
Thank you. And by the way, I don't mind saying, I have not gotten into an accident in over 25 years when my wheels were moving. I have gotten in 2 accidents, and both times my car was either stopped or in parked. I wasn't moving.
For me, I think I'm working on more than a decade as well.
Also never a speeding ticket and never a DUI ticket either.
Ever? Okay, cool. I'm not sure I ever had a moving violation. I know I got a ticket once, but
I've gotten moving violations, and both times I was driving about 10 miles an hour, and they were for illegal right turns on red lights.
I've got 2 in my life, I recall. One, I was in high school, where apparently a pedestrian was crossing the street, and I didn't give them enough time or something like that, and I was young. But that one was actually the police officer didn't show up.
Case dismissed.
Yeah, but then again, I didn't think there was a very good ticket, so maybe he didn't care, because I didn't think that they were on the other side of the street. It wasn't like they were close to me by any means. They just weren't on the sidewalk, I guess, and I had proceeded.
Yeah, no continuances for good cause if the ticketing officer or whatnot doesn't show.
Yeah, well, I guess you can call that one of the first victories I've ever had in my legal career. You know, the officer didn't show up. I go, it was a bad ticket anyway. The guy was on the other side of the block. I got it. You're supposed to let him get into on the curb, right, before you make a right, I think.
Well, technically, no one is supposed to be in the crosswalk when you cross that crosswalk in your car. And what a lot of people do, I know I do, is that
they're going the other direction. You can already pass behind the pedestrian, right?
Right. No, that's exactly correct.
Yeah, that's what I did.
If I'm in an intersection, right. Well, they were still in the intersection when you made the turn. The law says you're supposed to wait till they're on the curb.
But I argued with the officer about how close they were to the curb.
You know?
You know, he may have believed they were more towards the middle. I believe they were towards the, getting the step onto the curb. Either way, they were going the opposite direction of me. Not like I'm going to hit them with my car. I didn't.
Here's a question that I have. If I'm stopped at a red light, am I allowed to pick up my cell phone in my hand?
Oh,
The car is on. I'm stopped at a red light. The car is not moving. Can I have the cell phone in my hand? Because technically, I'm not driving.
But that's a technical question. I'm not sure. You got to talk to the judge. It's probably up to the judge.
Traffic court,
traffic court can be a little colorful, as you know. Right? Everyone's seen colorful traffic court.
Okay, updated Thanksgiving news. As Americans prepare to cook and consume nearly 50 million turkeys tomorrow, Thanksgiving Day, an ongoing outbreak of salmonella poisoning linked to the poultry means food safety at home is more critical than ever. Federal health officials having identified no single source of the outbreak of salmonella reading or salmonella reading, which has sickened at least 164 people in 35 states during the past year. As of November 5th, the bacterial strain has led to 63 hospitalizations, and in California, one person has died.
Many who fell ill reported preparing or eating such products as ground turkey, turkey parts, and whole birds. Some had pets who ate raw turkey pet food. Others worked at turkey processing plants or lived with someone who did. There is a U.S. requirement that turkeys or other poultry be free of salmonella, including antibiotic-resistant strains, like the one tied to the outbreak. So prevention falls largely to consumers.
And in another related story, for those of you that don't know, health officials in the United States and Canada have advised people yesterday to stop eating romaine lettuce because of a new E. coli outbreak. The United States Food and Drug Administration said it is working with officials in Canada on the outbreak, which has sickened 32 people in 11 different states and 18 people in the Canadian provinces of Ontario and Quebec. The strain identified is different than the one linked to the romaine lettuce scare earlier this year, but appears similar to last year's outbreak linked to leafy greens. And you might just want to throw away all your lettuce, because although apparently it's only restricted to romaine, if that romaine got on the same surface as, say, iceberg lettuce, your iceberg lettuce could be contaminated as well. So I threw out all of my lettuce that I had in the refrigerator, and I'm just going to wait till this is over.
Yeah, it's strange. A lot of food safety stuff this holiday season. More than usual, or maybe we're just commenting on it more. I don't know.
I think it's more than usual, and I think that it... I don't know what to think.
Well, salmonella is... I mean, this is going to be linked with safety. Safety and cleanliness standards, right? It's the only way. It's the way... So it's money versus precision in doing business. We can guess how food can get contaminated, right? It's when people are working in a sloppy, sometimes not clean manner, and they're prioritizing profit and speed over health and safety.
Yeah, the food is not being chilled at the proper temperature or in the proper container. People are not washing their hands before opening the food. The food is being left out, and then when the food is put on a surface, you're not cleaning the surface properly before putting more food on it.
And something like that. It's hard to investigate these types of salmonella cases, right? You got to find out where these outbreaks occurred. And sometimes it could be multiple locations. It could be, again, a confluence of events. It's tough. You're just going to have to wipe the slate clean everything out, and start fresh.
I find it generally occurs in one location, but then, of course, the food gets dispersed out to multiple states.
Sometimes.
But that could be wrong. I don't know.
Sometimes they can't even find the start.
Well, brace yourself for another Thanksgiving weekend when it comes to weather. Northern California could get as much as 7 inches, 18 centimeters, of rain, according to forecasters. The good news is that the downpour could help vamp out the remainder of the deadly fires, which we have confirmed has burned more than 150,000 acres in California. Then, of course, though, because everything's been burned out...
The mudslides,
right? The mudslides, which are really horrible, and we had that in the fires last year or whatnot.
You predicting mudslides also right now, too?
Oh, yeah.
You think it's just going to be... The hits keep on coming?
Well, yeah. Well, they've already given warnings for Pacific Coast Highway, because if you've ever driven on Pacific Coast Highway, it's... The road is right next to that huge... Or all those mountains, and because the fire is burned out, all of the loose rubble and trees and everything could just come loose, and you're going to see some cars that are going to be hit by huge boulders and such. And
I hope everyone stays safe out there and stay smart. Avoid the area if you can.
Totally agree.
Just avoid the... I mean, this is Malibu, though. It's kind of surreal. Malibu is a very high-priced place, right?
Sure. Then again, so is Thousand Oaks.
But Malibu is especially high-priced. This is where celebrities... Didn't Jenner's house get burned to the ground or something like that?
I'm not
Bruce
sure.
Jenner?
I don't know.
Yes, she did. Yeah, so it's hitting... Yeah, Scott
says yes.
So a lot of celebrities are losing their homes. These are million-dollar homes. The insurance claims on this just... I hope everybody had fire insurance.
Well, these are multi-million-dollar homes. $1 million for a home these days is practically standard.
Yeah, and these...
at least in California.
And when we're talking Malibu, we're talking the word estates, right?
Yeah,
you
estates,
like to use that
estates,
nice word to,
yes,
to add an extra million to it there.
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
And they do. So we're oh, man. You said $60
billion? What? $60 billion what?
From the damage? From the fires? To all this property? Estimating it?
Let's go on. I don't remember if I said that or not.
Well, it's in the billions, and I'm wondering how they're going to spread this cost around.
You got the next story, please.
Sure. Should I read the PG&E?
No, whatever summary? You want.
Let's
yeah,
do it. PG&E faces liability questions for the California wildfires connected to its distribution lines and had seen about half of its market value, roughly $12 billion, vanish in a little more than a week, Best reported. At issue is whether utilities should continue to be held liable for damages caused by wildfires linked to their power lines, even if the companies did nothing wrong.
Yes.
Close quote.
Yeah, speaking of PG&E, the proposed casualty insurance sector has limited exposure for the debt of troubled California utility PG&E, according to a briefing released this morning by AM Best Company, Inc. Approximately 10% of insurers have exposure to PG&E bonds by a number of entities Best reported. And, of course, now they're talking about when PG&E, when they do raise prices, should they be limited into how much they can raise their rates to help pay for the damage that they have contributed to?
We've had a rough couple of months here in Southern California and pretty much across the nation. But the hurricane season wasn't as bad, I guess you can say, in some sense, right? Right, boss?
Is the weather getting predictably worse because of global warming?
Oh, please, please. Are we going to start on this? This wasn't the part of this show. Global warming is a political issue, not an environmental or, how should I say, meteorological one, okay? It's a political issue.
Yeah, if you go back
100 years, here,
and
for sure,
and you
so
do
we can talk
the,
about
you
it.
You do the temperatures. I mean, the temperature has risen like half a degree on the average in the past 100 years.
I don't know if what they're saying. They blame every hurricane on that. You know, they used to blame hurricanes on women being not chaste. Okay, so I got to say, I don't believe it. I think we're living in one of the best times in the Earth's history. And our impact on it has been minimal. Pollution.
You really think so? Why do you think this is the best time? Why?
Well, the Earth's history is long, right? 4.6 billion years. And
yes.
I mean, if you start getting into like the ice age, right? We're not. What do you think we're going to do? Trigger an ice age or trigger in water world? We're going to live in water world here?
No.
Or another ice age, right?
The population is getting overcrowded. The middle class is being squeezed out. You've got more homeless than ever before. People are struggling to pay their bills. Yes, there's less unemployment, but look at the types of jobs and the money that's out there.
All right, well, I got you. We're doing well. I mean, business-wise, it's a question how we're doing right now. I mean, ups and downs, and I know it's going to work. We're going to definitely hit a rough patch for the insurers with these huge fires. But we're back to global warming specifically.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wonder what people are actually claiming the repercussions are going to be. I'm not talking about pollution, mind you. Pollution is real. Smog is real. Okay? Those things are all very real, and we have an effect on that and around our local environment. But we're
the
talking...
The condition is
correct.
Better. It's healthier now than
but
it
I'd
was
like
20
to separate
years ago.
The idea of pollution and global warming. Okay? Separating those two ideas is very important. One of them, is, in my opinion, is real. And the other is a political football to be carried by people based on economic considerations like international trade. I know John Coleman, the old founder of the Weather Channel and Channel 2 news anchor down in San Diego or something. He passed away a while ago, but he didn't believe in global warming. He did believe in pollution and in general. But climate change has always occurred in the Earth's history. We just got over an ice age, and then we all popped out, right? Isn't that the Earth's history most recently, as far as large environmental changes? The last thing that really changed big was the sea levels rising, the Bering Strait closing, you know, the ice age ending, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then we had the Industrial Revolution as the humans, blah, blah, blah. Columbus had come right before that. The whole bit, right? That was a change in climate. I can't believe they're not going to blame that on humans, right? No way. We didn't end an ice age and increase the water level. We were just there. So I'm sure probably back then, actually, there were people blaming this on each other. But that's the same thing we're doing here. Different than pollution, okay? You can't throw stuff into the ocean, plastic. You can see that. whether or not the Earth is going to change drastically and either turn into a water world and all the ice caps are going to melt, or trigger another ice age and we're all going to be cavemen again, I just don't believe it. That doesn't mean you have a right to go out there and pollute. You don't. Don't litter. Don't pollute. You know, limit your emissions. Smog and this. You know, that's all good. That's all limiting pollution. That's different than global warming.
And somewhat on topic, we have a regular contributor to the show. He is halfway around the globe. He's hanging out in Munich, Germany prior to that. He was a 45-year attorney and still has his ticket to practice law in California, but he's hanging out in Munich, Germany with his segment on Work Comp Matters is attorney John Scalia.
Hi, this is John with the International Report from Munich. Two events have dominated European news this week. One is Brexit, and the other is the murder of Jamal Khashoggi, the Saudi Arabian journalist who worked for the Washington Post. The Brexit coverage, if you're not British, is actually pretty funny. If any of you have ever heard the radio routine from Abbott and Costello about who's on first, that pretty much describes Brexit. I suggest you Google it and listen. The murder of Jamal Khashoggi, of course, is also very serious and engages Americans even more because it involves an American ally, Saudi Arabia. Jamal Khashoggi was murdered in the Saudi Arabian embassy in Istanbul, Turkey. He went in there to get some documents and never came out. Originally, the Saudi government said he had come out and they didn't know where he was. Well, as it turns out, the Turks have the Saudi embassy surveilled better than the CIA has a Russian embassy in D.C. surveilled. They have everything, so they could prove that Khashoggi never came out of the embassy. Well, once the Saudis realized that, they said, oh, well, it was all a mistake. And then they said, yeah, he did get murdered. And then they said, yeah, it was guys from the intelligence service. And then they said, but they went rogue. We had nothing to do with it. And certainly our leader, dictator, Prince Mohammed bin Salman, didn't know about it and had nothing to do with it. Well, this has created problems for the Americans. Oh, additionally, the Turks had the Saudi embassy so well monitored that they have a voice recording of the torture and death of Khashoggi. They gave the recording, of course, to the United States. Now, let's be clear about something. The Turks are no friends of human freedom. They're no friends of human rights. Erdogan is rapidly turning Turkey into a dictatorship, if it isn't already classified as one. And my personal opinion, he may end up putting it under Sharia law. Nonetheless, Turkey is an enemy of Saudi Arabia. They have conflicting interests and conflicting points of view all through the Middle East. Turkey is technically more of an ally of the United States because it's part of NATO. So the Turks love this opportunity to distance Saudi Arabia from American support. No question that's their motive. However, even though that's their motive, that has nothing to do with the truth. The truth is they have a recording of the torture and death of Khashoggi, and they gave it to Donald Trump. Trump, of course, said, oh, it's a terrible recording, it's human suffering, but I've never listened to it, and I'm not going to listen to it. That's an enlightened point of view. Why bother to listen to the evidence if it's unpleasant? Further, Trump has indicated that he has doubts, quote, put that in quotes, as to whether Prince Mohammed bin Salman, the current actual leader and actual dictator of Saudi Arabia, knew anything or had anything to do with the murder. Well, that's just plain ridiculous. Nothing can occur in Saudi Arabia unless Prince bin Salman says it's okay. Besides that, there were 15 guys flown to Istanbul for the murder and then flown back to Saudi Arabia. Now the Saudis have identified 5 or 8 of them and said they're going to put them on trial and ask for the death penalty. Of course they are, because those guys are going to say, yeah, we went rogue. Why? Because if they don't say that before they're executed, their whole families will be killed. So clearly, anything on the Saudi side is absurd to believe. The FBI, well, you remember them, that's the Federal Bureau of Investigation, the agency that Trump thinks can't do anything right, has already told Trump that, as far as they can tell, Prince Bin Salman was responsible. Well, as I said, that's just common sense anyway, because nothing can happen in Saudi Arabia unless he says it's okay. But Trump has indicated he's going to give a statement tomorrow as to what he thinks. Here's my money. My money says that good old Trump is going to say, well, yes, five or six Saudi agents went rogue, but there's no indication that Prince Bin Salman knows anything about this. He's going to do this, one, because he wants to make sure Americans continues selling weapons to Saudi Arabia, and two, because he could care less about human rights or murder or any of that stuff. I mean, personally, I think Trump is a joke. Well, he's worse than a joke. Wasn't there a TV series about him a few years ago? Yeah, I think it was called Jackass. Well, that's the view from Munich this week.
John, thanks again for another one of your valuable contributions. We look forward to more segments on the show. I'm going to give thanks after the musical break. So without further ado, he's La Familia. He's part of the Cherry Blue Storms. It's Mr. Glenn Lachlan and Baby, You're a Rich Man.
How does it feel to be one of the beautiful people? Now that you know who you are, what do you want to be? And have you traveled very far? Far as the eye can see. Baby, you're a rich man. Baby, you're a rich man too. You keep all your money in a good brown bag inside a zoo. What a thing to do. How does it feel to be one of the beautiful people? How often have you been there? Often enough to know. What did you see when you were there? Nothing that doesn't show. Baby, you're a rich man. Baby, you're a rich man too. You keep all your money in a big brown bag. Inside a zoo, what a thing to do.
And the Cherry Blue Storms on Work Comp Matters on the Thanksgiving show. We're going to get back to news in a moment. Of course, brought to you by A1 Law Santa Monica Tickets and ABC Rugs. But this is the Thanksgiving show. And, of course, much thanks to Work Comp Central, who has continued to support and sponsor the show. And I have just been advised that they are not going to be renewing us for a third year. And I want to take a moment where some people would be upset and pissed off. I couldn't be more thankful because they supported, they continue to support the show through the end of this year. I was given plenty of notice, which a lot of times on terrestrial radio, that wouldn't happen. If you are canceled, you are kicked off immediately because they don't know what's going to go out on the air. Okay.
Yeah, they're just not renewing the contract.
And of course, I had a handshake agreement with them about 2 years ago. And I've said many times, and I'll say again, I'm not an employee of WorkComp Central. I am absolutely an independent contractor. I couldn't have developed as much as I've developed so far without their help. And I just want to say to the guys there, Lee File, Jake Paris, all the people that help support the project, you know, thank you very much. Thank you for your continued confidence and support. And I assure you, I'm not going to let you down for the remainder of the year. Next person I want to thank is my protege, attorney Robert Ozeron, who has continued to support the show as well. My boy, thank you. Your contributions have been valued, and you help shape the show in the direction that it's gone and will continue to go. Dr. Michael Zima, who is not here, taking care of some personal business. He is my right-hand man. He keeps me in trouble and out of check at least 90% of the time. Thank you, Doctor. Appreciate that. Scott from Uncle's Studio, who takes care of the technical difficulties on each show. My best to you and your family and much continued success. And I advise Scott before this show, we will be doing year three of Work Comp Matters. We just won't be sponsored and put on Work Comp Central. But we're going to try some things and see how it works. And I'm hoping for a really good year three. Have to, of course, thank Jared, the IT guy, for his contributions, as well as Gina, the marketing and advertising gal. They have both contributed, and I thank them very much. Naturally, family, friends, and of course, special thanks to Crystal and Julie at Church and Law. You guys know who you are. And of course, last but not least, all the listeners, those that just listen, those that comment, and those that see myself and, you know, Robert in the halls of the Workers' Compensation Appeals Board. We thank you very much for listening. Robert, anybody you want to thank?
Wow. Well, thank you for having me contribute, boss. I appreciate it. And thank you to Scott for having me. It's a lovely studio here, and I've had a great time.
Oh, I forgot Ted, Mr. Ted Durden. Thank you, Ted.
Definitely to Ted and to Mike, to my employees, to everyone at the board, to the judges for being fair and impartial and, you know, listening to me, even when sometimes it might be difficult if, you know, you're really arguing your case strong and, you know, nothing's personal. I just want to say thank you so much for, you know, being fair all the time. Everything's a fresh new case. You know, you don't take it out on me ever if I lose one type of deal. And I appreciate that with the judges and the staff of the court as well. As far as family, you know, I thank my family for helping me out. I even had my aunt come over the other night and set up my kitchen for me. She wanted to organize it. And it was really nice of her. She made food for me, and it was really cool just to have like a family member come over and just do something nice for you.
You're in a new hood.
Yeah, I moved, and that's why.
Congratulations.
Correct. So my aunt came over, and I said thank you to her. But, you know, just family in general, having that. They say love is what makes a house a home, right? So whenever you move, you want to kind of invite people over and fill it with love. It's nice. And this holiday season, especially with the troubles we've had in Southern California, it makes you appreciate everybody a little bit more.
Dozens of homeless people evicted from an encampment under a Turlock overpass last week have resettled in the city's parks. The change has caused friction between the homeless and city officials at one park in particular. At least 30 people are staying in and around Broadway Park, a high-visibility park between North Broadway and North First Street near downtown and just two blocks from the Turlock Police Department. You know, there's something, I mean, I mentioned it earlier, homeless, no solutions yet.
Yeah, we only elected Governor Newsom, and he's coming from a district where it was the worst in the state, so I don't see...
San Francisco is horrible. I haven't been there in a while, but just reports that I hear, telephone conversations, dirt, trash, feces, and illness due to that is creeping up.
Well, definitely.
Yeah,
definitely. You can't deny the repercussions, right? It's kind of a dismay because we elected somebody who, where we have a problem like homelessness across all of California, especially Southern California and San Francisco as well. But San Francisco being the worst, and this is a problem that supposedly the voters and the people want.
Is San Francisco the worst?
I believe so.
Probably, yeah.
And this is an issue that supposedly the voters wanted to tackle. I get it. You only had two options, though, and it wasn't just on homelessness, after all. It's Republican or Democrat, simple as that. You got a binary choice. And people chose the Democrat. And not like the Republican candidate necessarily had any solutions offered either, I have to add. So
Republican candidate never had a chance, not in California. Not a chance.
Regardless of that, we're talking about, but it is a little bit disheartening that we have such a problem, and then the person that we elected comes from a district where it's the worst.
It's so disheartening to me that we have the fifth largest gross national product in the world, and we totally mismanage the money. I mean, California, the California budget has a surplus. I said this on the show before, and nobody believed me. I think California has, like, I don't know, they have a huge surplus, and the money is just mismanaged and misused.
Well,
and I'm sorry.
Sometimes you need to have a huge surplus to cover huge fires like what happened here, right? We're talking about billions of dollars. You have it being the cost of like five power companies put together, pretty much the value, you know, the total amount of damages caused. So perhaps you do have to have a state reserve fund with a fair amount of money in it. But yes, you wish that you could have perhaps a successful private businessman manage the California's finances like he would manage or she would manage their own business.
Mm-hmm.
But it's easier to be fast and loose with other people's money, right?
Right. It's always easier to spend other people's money.
Yeah, and if they've got a problem, you can just ask them for more.
And, you know, speaking of Gavin Newsom, the governor-elect has named two women with deep policy experience in high-profile posts in his new administration. Anne O'Leary, 47 years old, a lawyer and former senior advisor to Hillary Clinton during her 2016 presidential campaign, will be Newsom's chief of staff. She also served as co-executive director of Clinton's transitional team in the months before she lost the presidential bid to Donald Trump. Experience that should prove useful to Newsom as he prepares his own team. And I'm going to blow this, Anne Matasantos, 43, a budget guru and former financial director under both Governor Jerry Brown and former Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, will be Newsom's cabinet secretary. And speaking of Newsom, Robert, there's a story there somewhere. He's got 3,000 jobs available that don't require any political experience.
What do you mean by that?
I'm going to tell you in just a moment. He's looking to hire 3,000 people, and no political experience is necessary. You might have to give up your personal life to do it, though. Plan on having no life and working all the time, said Richard Costigan, who worked for Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger as legislative director and for Governor Jerry Brown as member of the state personnel board. If that sounds like it's fun, or you want a job, Newsom has a job for you. He's soliciting applications at his campaign website. That's gavinnewsom.com/get _involved, and he said he's looking for diverse voices and talents to run state government.
Yeah, and knowing Gavin Newsom, if you're a girl, you should attach a photo. The Division of Workers' Compensation, DWC, today announced its Eureka office has moved to the following address: State of California Office Building, 409 K Street, Room 201 in Eureka, California, 95501. The state office phone numbers remain the same from the former location on 8th Street. The Eureka office is a satellite of DWC's Santa Rosa office, district office, with a workers' compensation judge and support staff. INA and disability evaluation services are provided through coordination with the Santa Rosa and Redding offices.
Speaking of workers' compensation, of the 466,600 non-fatal reportable job-related injuries and illnesses in 2017, 78% occurred in private industry and 22% in state and local government sectors. Both the statewide all-industry count of lost time cases referred in the survey as days away from work, job transfer or restriction, or DART cases, DART, and the number of days away from work cases, DAFW, remained steady.
This is an interesting story. The State Bar of California released the results of the July 2018 California Bar Exam and announced that 3,284 people, which is 40.7% of all applicants, passed the general bar exam. The pass rate for first-time applicants was 55%. If those applicants satisfy all other requirements for admission, they will be eligible and to be licensed by the state bar to practice law in California. This means that the scaled multi-state bar exam score on the July 28th bar exam in California was 1404 compared to the national average of 1395, fairly close. The latest results mirror a national downward trend in scores from the July 2018 bar exams.
Now, I have a niece who's in her third year of law school. My son is in his first year of law school. And you passed your bar exam the very first time. What's the secret to passing the bar exam?
Well, I got to be honest here. I know I don't want to start bragging.
Well, I'm glad you don't lie, but go ahead.
Well, in a sense, it's kind of a... You know, you don't want to brag about, like, oh, I'm good at taking a test, but I'm fairly good at taking a one-time test. It's a one-time test. Now, when I took the bar, it was actually harder. It was a three-day exam. They've cut it down to 2 days, and
that,
still
that
trending
just happened
down
within the past year.
Last 2 years, yeah. I believe. But, I mean, I didn't take the test. I don't know. I took a three-day exam, and it was brutal, okay? And my pass rate total was very low as well. I was part of the downward trend. I just happened to be one of the first-time pass takers. You know, I'm one of the people bucking the trend still. And I was very thankful for that, by the way. I've been thankful for that every year, for being able to practice law and to represent people. Now, the trick that I had is patience, consistency, and focus. They're all... inward traits. There's nothing to do with the bar exam. It's a way of being the person you want to be. It's more than just one test. If you think it's about one test and you're cramming for it like it's bigger than you are, it's because it is bigger than you are in your own head. For me, it was just one thing that I was doing, which is it had a certain amount of components. You could break it down into individual parts, and from there you can deconstruct it to see what's important, right? For example, when I took it, it was 6 parts, 3 days, okay? Morning and afternoon, 3.5 hours each, right? It's a full day's work. Now, you had 2 multiple choice sections, you had 2 essay sections, you had 2 short answer sections, okay? So, and these are going to be mixed up, you know, you never know what you're going to get. You're going to wake up and Monday will be the short answer and then the afternoon will be the essay, Tuesday will be whatever. You can see how it goes. Now, the multiple choice is broken up to the sections that are tested on the bar, right? There's community property, there's trust in the states, there's constitutional law, there's civil procedure, there's criminal law and procedure. I hope I'm missing something. I think corporations was tested. Now, when you start taking enough of those practice exams, you can get a book, an MBE. It's a thick book of multiple choice question and answers, and it's broken down by section, and you just take it. And for example, constitutional law is a dead end. That thing does have, you can get 100% on constitutional law. It's not that hard. It just doesn't have any new things going on. It's a dead end. As soon as you do a couple of exams, you read the questions, you look at the back, at the answer, oh, I got it wrong, this is the right answer, it's over. Because that is one, and that's one of the sixth of all of the types of multiple choice questions. As far as the short essay and answer, you got to study your flashcards. I was doing books on tape. I would just go for a hike or a run, and I would just listen to the audio tape over and over. Repetition, right? Repetition is the key.
So audio tapes, well, and repetition. That's one piece of advice.
But this is just basic studying. You open the book, you take a couple of exams, you make some flashcards, you try, you take a practice test, you look at your mistakes, you try again. I studied for about 3 weeks and passed it first time, no classes, okay? And I downloaded the, don't get me, FBI, I was a poor student. I downloaded the audio tapes, okay? Didn't pay for it. If I could find the publisher, if I could even remember, I would promise you I'd send you $50 for what it is, okay? Just find me. You got it. I can't recall what it was, though. well, you can't remember anything about other areas of law after you pass and start practicing. It's almost true. You only remember the generalities. But these are not difficult things to do, to break things down and to be patient. But most of the studying that I saw other people taking part in was just worrying about how to study. Okay, I'm going to go here and I'm going to set up these books. Just get to work, dude. Just get to work. Everything is about how you're going to work when you start working. I just got to work. And simple as that. And while other people were worrying about, okay, my coffee mug will go here, and then I'm going to read this. I'm going to look at the answer. Okay, then I'll take another question. I'll look at that answer. By the time you figured out what you want to do and stopped worrying, I've finished, okay? So most of these people are beating themselves, is what I'm saying. It has nothing to do with the exam. I looked at the most recent, not this one, of course. This is new news. I was talking about the second most recent bar exam. I looked at the questions, basic questions, okay? No tricks. They're not trying to fool anybody. They're asking you a basic law school essay question. Just answer it, right? You don't even have to be a good writer. You can put it in bullet point format. Just show them that you know the legal idea that they are touching on. Issue, rule, analysis, conclusion. You IRAC your exams, okay?
IRAC. There you go.
Issue.
A lot of attorneys say that. IRAC.
That's how they teach you, right? And all that means is you should have a format or a skeleton for how you're going to respond. Because if you know how you're going to respond, you really just almost copy and paste the question right into the answer. And I'm not kidding when I say this. When it comes to the memo portion, which is the writing portion, I had never taken a practice test on that. I just walked in and took it. And I'm not joking. All I did was copy the question and reverse it back into the answer. It was almost a joke. I thought it was a trick. I thought it was some sort of trick. They ask you a long question, and at the end of it, you reverse in your answer. You start talking the ending first, and you're taking the terms right out of the question and put it in your answer. You just regurgitated the question and talked about it a little bit, and you're worried that what did I do? That made no sense. It's almost too easy, right? You get scared. Now, multiple choice, you can get that one wrong. You got to study that one. You got to put in your numbers. You got to take your practice test. You got to grade yourself and then go in the back of the book and look at the answer, read why it's wrong, and do it again. All right? There's 100 questions out there for every type of problem. So you're going to notice that there's the same question phrased many different ways. But there are definite ends. It's not like it's an infinite amount of knowledge. It is not. In fact, most of the things on the bar are not tested. I had a great, great professor at USC for law school. He passed away a while ago. His name was Charles Whitebread. Anyone who's listening to this, I suggest you would YouTube it. Charles Whitebread. I believe he was the in-house counsel for Ronald Reagan first time. And he was a very colorful man. And he used to do bar prep classes as well, just as a guest speaker, talking about the bar. And he would tell people, do you think, in a funny way, do you think that they're going to be asking you about bestiality on the bar exam, huh? What idiot is studying the elements to bestiality? Can you imagine the fact pattern that the essay writer would have to give you before you would venture into such a legal domain, right? Obviously, you're not going to study that. So if you're studying something like that, you're probably one of those people who ain't going to pass, okay? Either that or you're just extremely smart and you can just cover absolutely everything. But I doubt it, okay? So basically, everyone says they have a trick, but there is no trick. The trick
is
you. There is no trick. The trick is you. You just have to go in there, say you can do it. Believe you can do it. So many people are buried by this test because in their head, it's the hardest test. Oh my gosh, 40% on people pass only, 60% fail. Why would I be better than the average? It's a lot of it's self-confidence. I came in knowing I would pass. I was 100% sure. That false confidence, that false bravado you have to put on just so you can do something, you truly end up believing in it. You believe it at the end. You have to operate with that confidence that and when it's even too easy, you're worried. You're worried that I just regurgitated the question right into the answer. But if that's what it is, just, be confident and go for it. But if you're analyzing yourself over and over, getting ready to study but never working, and then, you work for 5 minutes, you're distracted on your phone, you need to focus on your focus.
And I think that is the key. Focus on your focus, minimize stress, you didn't say anything about stress, but you were sort of circling the wagons around that. Be confident of what you know is what you know, and just know that you're going to do it. Excellent words, Robert. Thank you very much. Well, the end of another great show, the Thanksgiving show. Got to thank my boy, my protege, attorney. I still pronounce it wrong. Attorney Robert Ozeron, talking about how to pass the bar exam, taking care of the technical difficulties from Uncle Studio, Mr. Scott Walton, back in Munich, Germany, Attorney John Scalia, and of course, all the good people back at WorkComp Central that continue to support and approve of what I believe is a very valuable project, including but not limited to Mr. Lee File and Mr. Jake Paris. My name is Steve Appel. We will see you again next week on another edition of WorkComp Matters.